This is Aussie Mac Zone. We'll cover everything Apple, including Macs, iPhones, iPads, and more. All this from an Aussie perspective. Sit back, relax, and insert yourself into the zone. The Aussie Mac Zone.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to show 204. Getting those ones up and running. So I'm lucky enough to have Garth with me. How are you, sir?
I'm well, Michael. How are you?
Not bad. We're getting latency straight away, are we? Yes, we are.
Yeah, we are. We'll start off the show as we mean to complete. Sheesh.
And iPad keyboard's just frozen. I don't know what's going on. There we go.
See, there's going to be a bit of editing to go.
So, yeah, as I said, 204. Garth, Michael, and Nick here tonight, and presented by athwebhosting.com.au. Affordable competitive plans, 99.95% uptime, domain registration, free setup, auto setup, instant activation, 250 scripts installed with one click. Includes WordPress and Joomla. cPanel, the industry standard user-friendly feature-rich control panel. All from $5.95 per month when paid annually. So, hi Nick.
Hey Michael, how are you?
Good mate. And Garth.
I'm still here. Just.
Just. Yeah, I'm making sure.
So hanging by a piece of Telstra, very fine thread.
Yes.
All the way of internet to my home.
We love them. So, the first thing is probably Hurricane Harvey on iTunes. They've got a donation page. Is that correct?
Absolutely. They haven't got Hurricane Harvey, the musical, on iTunes.
Not yet.
Give them time. Along with karaoke, carpool karaoke.
Yeah.
No, sorry. I shouldn't be so... I shouldn't jest about such things. No, but if you are wanting a way to make a donation, the Red Cross appeal for relief programs, due to Hurricane Harvey over in the US is available through iTunes. Now, I've just realized that might be a US only thing, or probably not though.
No, I don't think so. I've seen them before on the Australian site, yeah.
Yes, but usually, well, mostly you see them for non-US things, don't you? But this one is obviously a natural disaster within the US.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
No, so please have a serious think about it. That's what we're asking, yeah.
Basically, yes.
Yeah. So, our Aussie Apple ramblings, Apple wins Best Paper Award. Not a paper plane. But it's the best paper.
Oh, come on. My son would be in with a shot then. he'd give Apple a run for their money, I can tell you.
Excellent. Excellent. I've got
they
the
may
paper
just be
plane.
A proud father.
Yeah. So at the prestigious Machining Learning Conference, by coincidence. So after Apple decided to allow its researchers to publicly share their findings, its first academic paper was published at the end of last year. Now that research has just won a Best Paper Award at a prestigious Machine Learning and Computer Vision conference. The first academic paper to be published in connection with Apple was Learning from Simulated and Unsupervised Images Through Adversarial Training, and it was by Ashish Shrivastava, Thomas Pfister, Wansel Tuzel. I'm worried. Am I getting conned on that one?
No one fact check the pronunciation of these names, please.
Josh Susskind, Wenda Wang, and
come on, you're having a laugh now. Come on.
So I apologise to not pronouncing their names correctly, but
But I'm only gone. Human.
So The research on AI was submitted to the Conference on Computer Vision and Pattern Recognition, which is regarded as one of the most distinguished and influential of conferences in this field. Keep in mind, this was Apple's first publication of its research and one of over 2,600 submissions, and it won Best Paper Award, along with another submission, which is quite an impressive accomplishment. So we do have a link to the full paper and more of the story at 9to5Mac.
Do you get the sort of feeling that you'd like to read it and under the full understanding that you would have no idea what the hell it was talking about?
Yes. Yes, I do want to read it, yes. but yeah, I like the way it's under unsupervised images through adversarial training. So it's obviously fighting against itself somewhere along the line.
Yeah. I mean, look, as a blind person, this stuff is actually really important to me because it's and we're seeing it all the time, even, you know, as time goes on. The Tesla that I've ordered, you know, it'll be able to drive me somewhere and blah 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 blah. There's so many things that this changes the world for me.
Yeah.
The machine learning and, you know, the vision, the what do they call it? The not artificial vision, but image recognition stuff.
Yeah.
Well, and it already is, you know.
Though one of the other stories which I haven't got in here is Apple's new cars that they're using with all of the LiDAR on the roof. They've got even more on the roof now. And there's so many cameras up on that roof rack. It's amazing. Yeah. It's amazing how much stuff's up there.
And they're saying that they may be starting testing before too long with shuttles between different campuses. To shuttle. Oh, is that one of the stories tonight?
No, I didn't have that, but
yeah, so speculation that some of the first, you know, the Apple car is a lot further developed than we thought possibly, and one of the first things is shuttling employees between different campuses, different Apple campuses. So, shuttles.
I wonder if actually inside the new campus, they'll have electric vehicles, you know, they're like the little granddad ones we've got out here that are self-driving. So you just get on and say, take me to Tim's office.
Yeah, and quite possibly. And it says, bugger off, you haven't got an appointment.
It's only 3.5 kilometers from one side to the other.
Who the hell do you think you are?
So, story number two, iOS 11 beta code references Apple Pay cash card and a required photo ID. And since its announcement at WWDC 2017, details on Apple's upcoming person-to-person payment service has been sparse. Not having made any appearance in the latest iOS 11 betas, expectations have been set that we'll see an unofficial launch later this year. While we may have to wait, iHelp BR has uncovered some further details on what we may come to expect with final Apple Pay Cash release. Code references in the Apple Pay framework point to the fact that users have to authenticate the service using a driver license or photo ID, which so it should. You've got to use photo ID for just about everything these days, don't you?
I'm just still disappointed this is not coming to Australia and probably won't in the near future.
Yeah.
You know, because I think there's so many situations where this would be really cool to have.
Does that mean we've just got to get American bank accounts? And
oh, I don't know. I don't think we'll be able to because we'd have to have an American driver's license.
Donald will let us do anything if it means giving him money.
Oh, well, this is true. Maybe. Pay for an American driver's license?
Yeah.
Just need a friendly American who can give you their address probably and you're sweet.
Yes, with any luck. You've got an American car, or you'll have an American car.
Well, yeah. I was looking at the
license for.
I know. Estimated delivery date. early 2019. So, you know, we've got plenty of time to save.
But they are ramping up production.
Absolutely.
Now, we talked about this last week, but the court's thrown out a lawsuit blaming lack of texting lockout technology in iPhone caused car accident.
Thank God.
Yeah, a California judge has thrown out a suit brought against Apple by the father of a college student killed in a road accident by a texting driver. One where it was claimed Apple had failed to incorporate technology into the phone would prevent it from working while the user is driving. So how did the phone know who was driving? How did the phone know it wasn't a passenger?
How would it know?
That's right.
Yeah.
So unfortunate, and I feel for the family. Don't get us wrong, we're not having a go at that, but
absolutely. You can tell this sort of thing is just driven by grief, right?
But they have thrown that one out as well, so there's a couple now that they've anyway
told to take a sensible pill.
Now this one's good for a lot of people. I know there's people in my family that are already looking forward to it. Disney uses Pokemon Go like AR in iPhone app to promote upcoming Star Wars The Last Jedi. So Disney is going to promote upcoming movie Star Wars The Last Jedi using augmented reality on iPhones and iPads with a promotion that requires users to scan codes to unlock AR experiences with characters from the film using the Star Wars iOS app. So apparently you go into the store, scan the barcode, and all of a sudden on your phone you'll have characters from the movie, and then you can even take selfies with them. So, all in your Apple store.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad your family's excited about it, because I hope mine isn't. then again, I think we're breaking up. I'm losing you. Hang on.
No, we're still here. I can promise you. We'll keep talking. You just keep listening.
I'll keep trying. Yeah. Just keep going or without me.
But I've got a couple of Star Wars freaks in the family. So,
is that you, Michael?
Not me. No. No, not.
I heard you saying Pokemon Go when you were cutting out for me.
Yeah. No, it's a Pokemon Go like.
Oh, okay. Now I'm more interested.
So it's sorry. A Star Wars cutting movie, out. But it is a Pokemon Go like experience with the augmented reality.
Okay. Are they keeping it for iOS 11 when we get proper AR?
No, because it's... what was it? The 1st, 2nd, and 3rd of September, something like that.
So, okay. Ooh, misses it by that much.
Yeah. But, you can go and get a selfie, et cetera. So.
Yep. Sorry, making you tell the story twice.
That's all right, my friend. It's what I'm here for, just to look after you.
Okay.
So
I'll make sure I get to tell every story twice then. That's good.
Yeah, so don't forget, we do have Aussie Tech Radio, which... it's AussieTechRadio.com and the nice new artwork and stuff that Glenn's put up. And our sister podcasts, which are the Aussie Tech Security Podcast and the award-winning, voted by you, Aussie Tech Heads Podcast. So, you can have a month without Glenn there next month. So get in early and get as much as you can, just say.
What's Glenno up to for a month then?
Oh, he's going on holidays. The lucky
is he now?
Little mother.
He's a bit special, isn't he?
He is a bit special, yes.
Well, that came out wrong.
No, it didn't. And I've had some products for review lately, so I'll be knocking out some reviews in the next few weeks, which is very good for me.
So get on to Apple News and get subscribed to Aussie Mac Zone in Apple News.
That's right. Please do. Now, this is a product I haven't seen yet, but it is on Kickstarter, so I thought I'd mention it. It's called Lunar Display, and the very best way to use your iPad as a second monitor. So the makers of AstroPad have done it again, Lunar Display, which launched on Kickstarter earlier last week. It's a small $59 hardware module, USB-C or mini display port that lets you instantly turn your iPad Pro into a practically lag-free retina quality second monitor. And did I mention it was wireless too? So iMore has been testing a Lunar prototype for the last week and a half with their 13-inch MacBook and 10.5-inch iPad Pro, and will never want to travel without again. And why is hardware versus software? So if you've been keeping track of iPad as second display market, there are already a handful of apps that do basically the same thing, usually connecting to your Mac via a lightning cable to create a virtual second display on your Mac. There's one called Duet Display, which is, they believe, far and away the best, with the least lag and best image quality, but it requires being constantly tethered to your Mac, sacking battery life from your laptop and peg the CPU, and which makes it an even bigger power suck. But on the other side is AstroPad. The original AstroPad and AstroPad Studio apps made waves by creating a Wacom Cintiq-like experience for iPad users, mirroring your main display on the iPad Pro, adding in full touch and Apple Pencil support to the boot. And it did so with the option of going completely wireless thanks to its liquid technology. So if you've ever used...
Liquid technology?
Yeah, well, that's a proprietary... But yeah. I've used a couple of them as a second display sometimes. And yes, you know, if you really need a second display... So you can be doing two things at the same time, for example. It does come in handy. They are pretty good. I actually hadn't used the AstroPad Studio, where you get that Wacom type experience for drawing on what's relatively actually on your Mac. So, but yeah,
okay.
It is on Kickstarter. So people that want to get in early. $59 is a fair price.
Yeah, that's cheap enough, isn't it?
Yeah, when you think, a proper Apple Lightning cable is like $35. So.
Well, that's true. Yes. On a sort of off topic, a similar related topic.
Yeah.
You know how everyone's always calling for OS 10 to be touch sensitive, support touch display. What I didn't realize was if you hook up a monitor that is touch sensitive to OS 10, it'll work just fine.
Okay. Go on.
No, I wasn't aware of that either. No. Someone just told me they did it and it worked. Like the touches were sent through as mouse clicks, basically.
Yeah.
So not proper support, but a by default, sort of action would occur.
That's good, isn't it?
I
don't know how much touch you really need in it. Well, personally, I don't know how much touch you really need in a computer screen.
But look, are you saying that because you can't have it or because it wouldn't be good? I don't know.
On my iPad Pro, I tend to use the keyboard a lot. And not actually, move around too much with the touching the display, but that's just old school as well,
Yeah. See, my wife, she's got the keyboard cover thing, the Apple keyboard cover and a pencil. Yep. I don't think she knows where the pencil is because she doesn't use it. And the cover is basically just, a support. It just holds it up at the appropriate angle. So she... Yep. And she'll use the on-screen keyboard more than she'll use the actual keyboard.
But they definitely get iOS 11 is unbelievable. The changes that's brought to the world, I think.
Yeah.
As we discussed.
Now, what I will be, At last week, yeah. But what I'll be interested in actually is seeing how someone like my dear wife will take to it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, will it actually change the workflow much for someone who's basically using it for email and surfing the web and so forth? Filling out forms, like, filling out PDFs and things like that.
Yeah.
There is some issues with doing that currently. You've got to have these silly workarounds. So with iOS 11, it'll be interesting, I think, to see how much change that makes for someone who isn't trying to be a power user. They're just using it to do the stuff they need to get done in their day, you know?
But it's up to us to train those people. Advantages that we find. And it's all of the little ones. It's like just the little ones that helps that particular issue at that particular time. I think that's the ones we've got to rub into them and make them aware of.
Yeah.
Because there might be, we know there's hundreds of improvements, but only one or two are going to be of a big benefit suitable. That they'll want to use it all the time, isn't it? So,
yeah, well, that's right.
Yeah. So I'm running out of stories. What else you got for me, my friend?
Oh, crap, I was supposed to find a how-to before the end of the show.
And I'm sure you've done it.
I was very confident that I would find one. Clean forgot about looking for one.
I'm sure you've done it. I've got so much trust in you.
That's very...
While you're thinking, I'll just apologise.
Very poorly placed.
I stuffed up with last week's show something terrible. So we had two issues. One is the video we recorded... We actually forgot to record the video, so we've only got the Facebook video. And secondly, the audio file I put up, I did a typo when I put it up, so it hasn't actually gone up. So I'll have to make sure they're both up tonight.
Oh, I thought it was going on.
Yeah, that's my fault. I'm an idiot. But we all knew that.
Well, so
I have to resolve that tonight.
No one wanted to say anything, but...
You're all too kind.
No, where's it gone?
It's under.
No, I must have deleted the iMore. There was an iMore thing that looked pretty interesting, so I was going to say that, but I can't even find it now.
I had another. While you're looking, I had another one today again where the computer was saying that there weren't any photos on the phone. Was saying there's no photos on the phone. But you plug another phone in and work perfectly. And in this particular case, you go into iTunes and Advanced and say, rewrite the cache and rewrite the... What's the right word? It's the one above cache. Now I've forgotten the name. But that and restarting the phone fixed it. But you had to do both parts.
Okay.
And then all the if the 1,200 photos came back straight away.
Okay. All right. I haven't found it, but I've thought of something else that I wanted to quickly cover.
Thank you.
So got a phone call this morning on my way to work, and someone, their iPhone is starting to be a bit weird. You know, doing stuff. Shutting down, opening apps when it shouldn't do, and so forth. So I thought, well, before I take it to the Apple store where they'll want me to re-image it, well, that's a bit of a Windows term, but, reset it and so forth, I'll do it myself. So they just called up to ask, look, should I do an iCloud backup? Should I do an iCloud restore or an iTunes restore? And so we covered a couple of quick things. Firstly, iTunes, did you encrypt your backup when you did your iTunes backup? And of course, the reason for that question, as you would know, Michael, and as most of the listeners will probably know, is if you have encrypted your backup, when you restore from that backup, many, many more of your passwords will come back with the backup.
And your messages otherwise, and something else too.
Health data.
Yeah.
A few things like that, But you need to have encrypted that iTunes backup.
Yep.
Now, the other thing, and the main reason I wanted to mention this, is the watch. Because a person mentioned, and I have an Apple Watch. And the thing that I think people should know, if you're going to restore your phone, going to do anything like that, it's a good idea to unpair your watch first, because in the act of unpairing, it will write a backup of the watch to the phone's backup.
Yes. Yep.
Yeah. And it makes it that much easier when you then redo your phone, whether you restore from the backup or whatever.
Yep.
To reset your watch and have it come back and be able to restore from its backup as well. Just saves a few steps. So if you are going to be doing anything like that with your phone, resetting it, make sure you unpair your watch first.
Yep.
Just so that you get a fresh copy, a fresh backup of that watch before you do it.
Yes, very important. Very important. Can't stress about backups enough. But
multiple backups, every way you can back it up.
Yes, of course.
Keep backing up so much until you're going forwards.
That's exactly right. One day you will thank us. You might get annoyed with us between now and then, but one day you will thank us. I'd just like to, this is unsolicited, like to praise Sennheiser again. The amount of, like, the spares, they're a bit annoying to get on, you know, you got to get on the website, and I had to ask a question about a spare part, and they said, yes, this is the part number, and blah, blah, blah. And it was just a little rubber clip that goes on their Bluetooth microphone headset for, you know, talking in the car. And I needed to get a new one because I'd broke mine. And it's just the little earpiece, not the whole microphone and stuff. They carry that as a spare. I think it was, you know, $8.90 or something, and $5 postage. So they carry spare. Mm-hmm. They still carry spares for stuff that I got for my 21st birthday. So I'm a happy man. I love Sennheiser.
21st birthday, Michael.
That was a long time ago, mate.
I wasn't going to say that, but wow.
They still carry the foam that goes on the headphones that I got for my 21st.
That's insane. That's amazing.
And people buy them because they sound so good. The people buy the parts and build up the headphones because you can't buy them outright anymore, but you can still buy all the parts.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
So, yeah, I love Sennheiser, and just a simple little plastic clip that I know other companies don't keep as parts. Sennheiser have it. So maybe it'll fit your ones that where the companies don't actually have them. So
maybe. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you.
Very good.
Sennheiser.
I think that's a show for tonight.
That's a show for tonight. And the lag went away eventually. So beautiful.
It did. Well done. Well done, Telstra.
Thank you, Nick.
No worries, Michael.
Thank you, Garth.
Thank you, Michael. And thank you, Nick. And thank you, listeners.
Thank you. That's right. Thank you to our listeners, the sponsors and the supporters. All the best.
All right. Good night.